for the Lord Jesus a wonderful round of applause. Brethren, it's with great joy that we should present ourselves to God, and it's with faith that we have to fight against all evil in our lives. In the book of Matthew, chapter 9, it talks about that man who was paralyzed for his whole life. And when Jesus was preaching the word in the house, a group of his friends went to get him, and he was brought by four men. He couldn't even put his feet on the floor. He was completely paralyzed. But when Jesus saw the strength of the faith of the four men, and then Jesus told the paralyzed man, "Your sins have been forgiven." Nobody could understand anything. But Jesus knew that in order for the power of God to work in a life, the person has to have faith and believe in the word of God. Sometimes a person is well with religion. The priest will hug them and visit them, has fellowship with this person. And it could even be a Catholic father or a pastor. They have a real fellowship between them. But the person doesn't receive anything from God because this person is in debt with God. And it might not be adultery or robbery, but it could be hatred. It could be an idolatry act or the practice of witchcraft or something that the person has that the Word of God condemns, but this person holds inside or worships. And this is even worse than other sins that are more disgusting. So when the person reconciles with God and all is well, they believe in the word, the sins are forgiven, and there isn't a blockage anymore. God's work no longer has any limits. Then this person can receive the word from the Lord like this, where it says, "Stand up, get your bed, and walk." And all of this happened because Jesus saw the faith of the four men. It's no use if you keep telling yourself, "I have faith." My brethren, when evil comes, if you don't have faith, or if you have it and you don't put it into action, the devil will beat you. On your day of distress, if you show yourself to be weak, that you can be defeated, your strength will be small, and the enemy's strength is huge. The light that is in you, brethren, it can be increased and all of your body can be lit up. But if you have an opposite light, an inversion, if you have fear or respect for the evil, if you fear the devil's actions, or if you've been pleasing the enemy, the darkness that is in you is going to be very big, and it's going to be very difficult for you to get free. Unless there is a lot of intervention from someone that belongs to God and believes, and from someone who puts the word of God into practice. So put into your heart, "God needs to see my faith in action." Your faith is shown through your actions, not because you do them to show off or to be applauded by others, but you do them according to God's word, that you don't accept that, and you go before God as a true warrior of the Lord. You know, as Jacob did, as David did, as so many others did, and every one of them were victorious. It's necessary that God sees your faith in action. It's necessary that you act on it. It's necessary that you demand and that you fight for your right, that you hold on to what is yours and never let go. "I'm not going to let go, and this evil will not come to me, and what came is going away," and you will realize that your entire body will be lit up and there won't be a part of it that evil may hold on to. What is evil holding on to in your life? Where is he acting right now? In which organ of your body, in which part of your body, or your soul, of your thoughts, of your dreams, is he working somewhere else? That part belongs to him. And from there, he is going to increase. He will end up dominating you completely. Today is the day for us to look at the Lord and believe, "I'm going to make a stand in my life. I'm going to get through this. I'm going to demand that evil leave, and I am going to be truly blessed by God before I leave here today." And God wants you to be blessed. God wants you to receive everything that he has in store for you in the name of Jesus. Amen. But now, brethren, let's listen to the good word of God, because that's going to help us a lot. Let's go now to the book of James, chapter 5. The verses today are chapter 5, starting with verse 16. Verse 15 talks about the prayer of faith and how it can heal the sick and how it changes us all completely. And in verse number 16, the Holy Spirit says this: "Confess your trespasses to one another and pray for one another that you may be healed. I'd like to explain. So we cannot confess to just anyone. Confess to the person we've offended. If you've offended me and I offended you, I look for you and confess. We confess to one another so we get things right, in other words. The church needs to do that. Now listen to what I want to share with you now. This is not part of the teaching. And pray for one another that you may be healed. The effective, fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much, very much. Who is talking here is the Holy Spirit. And now he's going to give us a great example. When you are reading the Word of God, you are seeking Jesus. You're assuming what Jesus says. You are walking along in this light. And your entire body and your entire being and your soul and everything is going to be illuminated. There won't be any darkness in your life, so remain steadfast with the Word of God. And you are in the condition of being righteous. So then a problem comes up. But that doesn't mean you should stop being righteous and become a disgusting person before God. Oh God, you've promised. Why am I suffering? God is good, brethren. Never have a doubt in your mind that God has no trace of evil in him whatsoever. He doesn't look down and say, I'm going to make this person suffer a little so she can realize how life is. No, God wouldn't do that. This person is the one who has looked at evil and accepted some of the devil's works, and he comes and he will touch this person because the door was opened for him and they receive evil. So the righteous person always has to be aware. The prayer that I am reciting avails much before God, very much. In the following verse, the Holy Spirit tells us this. Elijah was a man with a nature like ours, and he prayed earnestly that it would not rain. And it did not rain on the land for 3 years and 6 months. And he prayed again, and the heaven gave rain, and the earth produced its fruit. Here it is all summarized. We know that he never did pray again. He, in a period of prayer, prayed 7 times for the rain to come. 7 times he knelt down, put his face in the middle of his knees, and then he cried out to God with all of his heart, Secretary, go out there and check the horizon to see how is the sky. Prophet, very clear, there's nothing. For the second time, he knew that the prayer of a righteous man avails much. On the third time, nothing. Fourth, fifth, sixth time, nothing. On the 7th time, the folk came and said, there is a little cloud over there. It's the size of a man's wrist. What is that? And he responded, that's enough. The answer is coming. And it came. And it was very strong rain that solved the problem of that drought, the drought that was simply ruining the lives of those people. My brethren, what is the lesson that we have here? If you're living in the Word of God, the light of God is shining on you. Make this light bigger. Let this light take over your entire being and you're going to be luminous. Then you'll be the righteous one. Have you got a problem? Have you prayed? Don't stop. Do like the prophet Daniel did. 21 days of prayer. On the 1st, nothing happened. The 2nd, the same. On the 10th, on the 18th, nothing happened. On the 20th, nothing happened. But on the 21st day, the angel appeared to Daniel. And when it happened, the angel said, Daniel, you're a beloved man. Why was Daniel so loved? Because Daniel loved a lot. This is in John 14:21. He who has my commandments and keeps them, it is he who loves me. God inspired Daniel to pray and seek an answer. And Daniel prayed and the answer wouldn't come. And most people would say, I don't want to know about God. He forgot about me. I'm going away. This is over for me. But no, he remained the 2nd day, the 3rd, the 4th, the 5th, the 6th, the 7th, 21 days. On the 21st day, the angel broke through the evil's pressure. Jesus hadn't overcome the principalities and powers, and a stronger angel had to come, and he broke through and brought the answer. Oh, Daniel, man, greatly beloved. But why? Because Daniel loved a lot. He who loves a little will be loved. People that love little won't reach much. It's necessary to be like Elijah. He prayed once again, but this other time means that he said seven prayers while he was out there. I don't know for you if it'll be 70 or 700 or 7,000. Do it. Don't give up on your right. That is what God is saying. But much sooner than we even believe, we'll be able to open the door so that the Lord can come and work. And when God comes and works, God changes the picture. It's been hard, Dr. Suarez. I'm bankrupt and I can only afford to eat macaroni and cheese. That's fine if it's only macaroni and cheese. Keep eating it. That's fine if it's only potatoes. Keep eating that. That's fine if it's only greens. Keep eating it. God is working so that your faith can grow. Because when he sees your faith, as he saw the faith of the four friends of the paralyzed man, he's going to start the process of purification that is necessary in your life. Without holiness, nobody will ever see the Lord. You're not going to see him. What you are needing is a purifying wash. You need a regeneration. It's a sanctification. You need to stand right up and go and get God's blessing. And when you get God's blessing, you can write, "Today, I got my victory in the name of Jesus." Elijah prayed. I'm not sure to stop raining. It doesn't say how long he prayed, but what it says is he prayed and the rain stopped. I'm not sure if it was only seven, if he had experience, if he had done this doctrine before, or if it was 14 or 21. The Bible only says that he prayed. He prayed for the rain, but seven prayers. He prayed first to stop raining. We don't know how many times, but he prayed to God and it didn't rain. According to the word of God, the sky stopped. The work of nature was suspended right there and then. It cannot rain until I pray again and order it to rain again. Dear brethren, we have lots to learn from God. I consider myself a mere beginner, you know. I'm still in the beginning of the spiritual world. I'm still learning the alphabet here, learning how to write the vowels, and I'm still a beginner at it. And because there are so many good things yet for us to learn, that if we learn them, our people will begin to see better because they'll see that we are improving. We are receiving the word of God and we are praying and these people will become blessed. He cried out on his knees on the floor. He prayed to God, "Lord, you cannot let it rain. This will not happen." And the rain didn't come. It was punishment because the people were in idolatry. They were completely lost in the devil, being guided by Ahab and his wife Jezreel, a completely crazy couple that were king and queen of Israel, and they led the people to a decadence and the worst spiritual decline that a nation can have, and they had a tragic end, both Ahab and his wife, and they lost everything because they gave themselves to the devil. The darkness that was in them, it was so dark, and it just became darker because they amplified the darkness in such a way that God didn't have any other option except to let Elijah pray. And Elijah did that, and for 3.5 years, it didn't rain. And did God work in those days? Yes, he did. But according to the Bible, no help was sent to widows, although there were many in Israel in those days. Jesus said that with the exception of one from Zarephath, Sidon, because God saw the faith in her heart. If she had not shown to God all of your faith, Elijah wouldn't have been sent, the help wouldn't have arrived, and she probably would have lost her life and her son. And she said, "I may go in and prepare it for myself and my son, that we may eat it and die." And Elijah said to her, "Do not fear. Go and do as you have said, but make me a small cake from it first and bring it to me, and afterward make some for yourself and your son. For thus says the Lord God of Israel, the bin of flour shall not be used up, nor shall the jar of oil run dry until the day the Lord sends rain on the earth." But God didn't send the rain because he decided to. It was faith. Prayers from someone who used to cry out down on their bended knees, face in the soil, crying out to God, and the seventh time God heard him. I don't know what you have to do, but I am certain that there is a message for you from God. The fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much, but this righteous man has to be in the light of God, shining all over. Let this light expand so that there is no darkness. And when God is able to see your faith in action, as he did in the first four friends of the paralyzed man, he's going to say, first, that your sins have been forgiven. and that you need the forgiveness. Don't play with God, especially if you don't know what the devil is plotting, be it against your health or be it against yourself or against your family, and what's about to happen. Jesus was very clear to that man that he healed who was paralyzed. For 38 years he was paralyzed, and he was sitting there by the well. He was waiting for 38 years. He was sick, just there by the well. Maybe he was 58 or 60 years old. He was an adult when he went there, and he had already been sick, but he became sicker and paralyzed. And this man who could not stand up for 38 years, and Jesus healed him and said to him in the temple, "Watch and do not sin again, so that nothing worse happens to you." And the sin has to be forgiven, because if the light that is in you, if your understanding is darkness, what great darkness it'll be. And you're going to make it bigger, and you'll be dominated by it, and then there will not be turning back. In this case here of the four men, they took the paralyzed man, and Jesus saw their faith. In Elijah's case, he prayed 7 times, "Master, there's nothing." The possibility of God not answering didn't cross Elijah's mind. He prayed for the 2nd time, the 3rd, the 4th, the 5th, and on the 7th time, God sent the answer. Brethren, the word of God. Let God witness your faith, and God will answer you. Let us pray now. Dear God, how many times do I have to pray? How many times does anyone have to pray? Until their faith can be seen and become the answer, God. And then begins the sanctification process, the cleaning process. Oh God, we only obtain this through the work of your holy word. It has the ability to cleanse even the most hidden corners of our souls. And God, that is what we're asking today. And we're begging, God, begin this process in our lives, the sanctification process. God, oh God, we want the word and your promise to become our light within us, and not darkness, because our entire being has to be bright, dazzling, and shining, O Father. God, the light has to be very bright in the most hidden corners of our lives. And then, Father, there will be no more devil's work. Father, we know that Satan is evil. And if the light that is within us becomes darkness, inverted light, God, our body will be all gloomy. God, everything that could happen bad will happen, and that can't be, God. Within us, the only thing that has to happen within us is your will. God, I'm going to bless this person who is praying. In the holy name of Jesus, I unite my faith with yours, and I rebuke this force of evil. I say, devil, take everything that is yours and leave. I'm ordering, go away from that shoulder that seems to be displaced. I'm ordering you, in the name of Jesus right now, go away. Take everything that belongs to you. I rebuke all evil action and say, out, in the name of Jesus. Thank you, God. And amen. Oh, glory to God. Amen. And now let's go to the real-life drama for today.
I used to enjoy parties a lot. I would go out frequently. Sometimes I would leave my house looking for something that I couldn't find, you know. The next day, the emptiness would come back, and sometimes even worse.
And then I would say to Eder, let's go to church, right? And he didn't accept going.
I never really enjoyed hearing about Jesus, you know.
I was the only one that sought my faith. Nobody else, but I asked people to pray for them. I would bring people to pray at home, and my sons, you know, didn't like it.
I would jump out the window, I would run, I didn't like it.
Then I would say, give me your tithe so I can take it. He would give it so I could, but he wasn't happy, but he gave it.
Even not believing in God, even not believing in anything, since I was 15 years old and working, I would give tithe.
Until one day he decided to go to church.
I was close to my car at work, and a car passed by saying that the singer called Fernandes Lima would be here, and I had no idea who he was. And my mother used to watch a faith show, and she always saw Fernandes Lima. Then, at home, everybody got excited, wanting to watch him, my father also. And she invited me to go that day. Then I started going every Wednesday, you know. The enemy is so dirty that sometimes I would leave in the middle of the meeting because I didn't want to stay there.
One foot in church and the other in the world. I considered that totally wrong.
For a long time I did it. For a long time. And inside of me, I was fighting against it, you know.
Faith show. I would put water there and anoint his shoes, his sneakers. I asked God to hold him at home so he wouldn't go to nightclubs, you know?
Slowly, I started going to nightclubs, and I didn't enjoy them as much until I stopped going.
Until the day he really decided to stay at the church.
After I was baptized, it took me about 6 months, and then I became a worker in the church. And then I didn't understand much about sponsorship. I started watching the faith show and Dr. Suarez talking. And through this, lives are being touched, you know. The gospel is going all over the place because of sponsorship.
Then he started to be a sponsor, and then he started growing more and more, you know. He would always say that he wanted to have his own business, a store.
I worked, and at night I would sell clothes to my friends. With the little money I had, I went to Sao Paulo and bought equipment to open up a store. Everything to set up my store. And I had nothing to sell, you know.
His former boss offered him some clothes so he could sell them.
And there was a store that was in debt with us. And this store closed down. And we got the merchandise to pay the debt. Would you like to check these clothes to see what you can use? When I got there, I saw my store completely full. Then I asked, how much do you want for all of these? He said, you can pay me $100, $200 every month.
It was a miracle because he couldn't afford it.
The door that God opens, no one closes. And if he closes, he opens a bigger one. Some time ago, I was going through a difficult situation, you know. Then I started talking to God, and he said to prove him, you know. That's when an opportunity came up for me to own a different company, you know. And after closing the deal with them, it testified in my heart. The other side of the verse, you know, if I close a door, I open a bigger one. And today I see that he fulfilled the second part. I have two stores. I sell electronics, I give assistance to cell phones. And today I'm a sponsor of the Faith Show and of USAM, which is a group of entrepreneurs.
He has more. He has two stores, a new car, you know.
Today I'm free, cleansed, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb.
Yes, today he is God's servant. He works at the church. He is a blessing.
In my financial life, the Bible says, you know, that those who are faithful in their tithes can prove of him. And the sponsoring, right? Because if you have this call, you know, if you have it, receive it with joy because, you know, God has great things for us.
Oh, God, you're wonderful. Eder, if you had continued in the mess, your life would have been all messed up.
Yes, it would be, Dr. Suarez.
And today you wouldn't be here giving us this beautiful testimonial.
God, he rescued me from darkness and gave me this opportunity.
And then you began to prosper, but you said that you have also been washed and redeemed in the faith of God.
In the name of Jesus.
In the name of Jesus, said there, go with God, may he bless you, and stand strong.
Amen.
You never know what God has in store for you. Let's give Jesus a round of applause. Brethren, now let's go to the question and answer segment.
Dr. Suarez, does God like intellectual knowledge?
Of course he does. God is the author of everything. Nobody is inventing anything. People are discovering what already exists, all the things that he has created, material as well as intellectual, and people start to understand them. You know how it is with other languages. when we feel surprised and we are amazed because the person says blah, 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 but it's not just blah, 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 it's their language. But it's more or less the same way we talk, but with different words, and all of these God's created. In any language, what commands is the verb, and the person learns the verb and then goes further. And it's beautiful to realize the richness in details. The other day I was reading some words in Indian, you know, Brazilian Indian, and I was amazed with some things. For example, São Paulo has a road called Anhanguera. And you always go down the road of the old devil. Did you know that it means old devil in their language? But there are others as well, you know. Beautiful stone is... I'm not going to say because you'll laugh at me afterwards and I'll get it wrong. I can't remember just everything, you know, but let's go now to the second question for today.
Is it wrong to ask for our parents' and grandparents' blessing?
Well, asking for blessings from your parents and grandparents is a habit. Some people don't ask. They just say good morning, good afternoon. It's an act of respect. But I remember when I was a young boy, God called me to teach a lesson to my uncle, who was a police sheriff. And he would say, take this blessing. He was married to one of my aunts. And I would reply, good morning, good afternoon. Why didn't I take the blessing? Because he didn't belong. How could he say, God bless you, if he didn't serve God? And I think that impressed him, because right before he died, he converted. And he stood strong with Jesus. And I told him, now I can take your blessing. Now you have a blessing to give me. But when I was still a boy and he said, take the blessing, I answered, good morning, are you fine? All fine with you. I think I was the one who had a blessing to give because I belong to Jesus. And God knows what he's doing. And now, well, let's pray together now. God, all of my faith is in favor of this person. And I now rebuke all evil from those who are praying with me now. And I say, evil, go away from this life in the name of Jesus.